avenues which could have been explored, and it doesn't appear that they did so.
To put some people in work with children is like putting an alcoholic at work in a distilling factory.
That's First Sight, next Thursday, 7:30 on BBC Two.
A seasonally busy week of animal emergencies. On 24-hour call with the RSPCA, the Animal Hospital on BBC One now.
As a doctor, people often ask me, are all operations strictly necessary? Well, the short answer is yes. And yes, we always wash our thermometers in between patients. We all drink a sensible amount of alcohol. And we find all our patients a pleasure to treat. Oh yes, and all surgeons are equally good. I mean, have you ever seen a botched nose job? The truth is, some medical treatments have no scientific backing. So, should you believe a word we say? Find out on Trust Me, I'm a Doctor. Thursday.
Wednesday.
BBC Two, 8 o'clock. Honest.
Journey through the human mind to a world out of control.
I've been possessed.
At the mercy of an overpowering disease.
Shane has Tourette's, a condition that causes sudden convulsive movements and noises.
Misunderstood and isolated.
He couldn't walk down the street without being attacked by people.
Explore Shane's world.
I'm a cosmetic nuisance. What's a blemish?
With Oliver Sacks, The Mind Traveller, tonight, 9:30, BBC Two.
Leaving behind the road to hell, Top Gear takes a trip with rock star Chris Rea in half an hour. Fact meets fiction now on BBC Two in the Works.
I think this is really very strong branding.
Bestseller after only her second book.
Her fifth novel.
Massive, full impact visual advertising with the Minette Walters name.
Bestseller list. We have to get as many people as possible to meet her.
A search for the truth in a story beyond belief.
Skull's Bridal, The Ice House, Darkroom.
The Sculptress.
All right, yes, I'm a best-selling crime writer, and I can solve crimes on paper. But what I like best is getting inside people's heads and seeing what makes them tick. So, can I solve a real mystery that happened 62 years ago? Particularly one which was so bungled by the police that the details, even at the time, were confusing. It's a challenge no self-respecting crime writer could resist. This is the story. In 1934, part of one of the largest and most important paintings in the world was stolen from the Belgian town of Ghent. The stolen painting, known as The Righteous Judges, by the Flemish master Jan van Eyck, was worth a staggering £10 million in today's money. It has never been seen again. The mystery is, what did whoever stole it do with the painting? Where are the righteous judges? And can I, as a crime writer, shed any light on the mystery of the missing masterpiece? The answer to these questions lies across the channel. It all began on the night of April the 10th, 1934, when two panels from Van Eyck's Adoration of the Lamb disappeared from Ghent Cathedral. The theft outraged Belgian society. It was as if the crown jewels had been stolen. especially when it became clear that the police lacked the experience to solve the crime. The most scathing critic of the police's bungling investigation is the ex-police chief of Ghent, Carol Moutier. He's been obsessed with the case for 40 years. He's even written a book about it.
Zeer vlug was de pers daarvan op de hoogte.
The press heard about it very quickly, and when the police arrived at the cathedral at about 9 o'clock and went to the chapel to begin their investigation, the chapel was full of, I would call them, sightseers, you know, the sort of people who go to look at scenes of disaster. What happened next is unbelievable. Because there were so many people there, the police left without having established anything and went on to investigate another case, namely the theft of some cheese.
Namelijk een diefstal van kaas.
What had been stolen was a black and white painting of St. John the Baptist and a rich, detailed portrait of the great and good of late medieval society called the Righteous Judges, seen here on the far left of the altarpiece. This, of course, is only a replica. The original never came back. Even behind a protective glass case, the scale and sheer visual power of the 24-panel altarpiece takes the breath away. It also happens to be one of the most influential oil paintings in the history of art.
There was a furor about the theft, because of the vandalizing of one of the most precious paintings of the art history of the Low Countries. Well, what Jan van Eyck did is use the oil paint in a very elaborated way. And this is one of the first paintings in which oil painting is so perfectly done. Through that oil paint technique, Jan van Eyck could reach an enormous realism, and what we can also see is, for example, the town which is depicted in the main panel. He is using buildings of those days, of the 15th century. He's trying to put all that biblical iconography, he is putting this in, for his days, in a contemporary decor.
500 years may have passed since Jan van Eyck completed his masterpiece, but he'd feel at home in Ghent today. Many of its original medieval buildings are still standing. It's just the sort of unlikely place I'd choose as a setting for a novel about the art crime of the century. It's provincial, picturesque, and above all, peaceful. So it's no surprise that the police inquiry was underpowered, because they'd never dealt with a crime of this magnitude before. But it was a great story for the Belgian newspapers. They splashed reconstructions of the crime across their front pages and made the police job even harder by confusing potential witnesses. The investigation was going nowhere when 3 weeks later, the first of 13 ransom letters arrived, demanding 1 million Belgian francs for the return of the paintings. It was written in French, which at that time was the language of the educated in Belgium.
The Bishop of Ghent received a letter which was typed in French and signed D.U.A. by an unknown person. In it, the unknown person said he had the two stolen paintings. He said he would return the first painting for nothing as proof that he had the more valuable of the two, the righteous judges, and he wanted 1 million francs for the return of that painting.
Six weeks after the theft, the bishop agreed to pay the ransom. As proof of his own trustworthiness, DUA sent a left luggage ticket from Brussels North Railway Station, which led the authorities to the panel of St. John the Baptist. It had been deposited the previous day and was well protected, wrapped in black oilcloth and brown paper. It was intact and undamaged. But the bishop went back on his word. The Van Eyck altarpiece was actually owned by the Belgian state, and under pressure from the government, the bishop refused to hand over the million francs. Not surprisingly, DUA refused to return the painting. His next letter showed how angry he was.
To break an agreement at the very moment when we were negotiating a relatively small ransom in proportion to the value of the most precious painting in the world is inconceivable.
That left the police with few clues, no rail leads, and a stalled investigation. I'm a prison visitor at Winchester Prison, and this is where I usually come for professional help with my novels. Everyone in here has an insight into why crime happens. But to help me solve the mystery of the missing masterpiece, I need to speak to an expert, and Mark Lawless is that man.
I certainly think if they were professional thieves, well, they wouldn't have stolen these paintings, because these paintings are priceless. I mean, there's no way you can sell them unless you've got some sort of oddball art collector who might keep them forever secret, which is very, very doubtful. You just couldn't sell them. The ransom game, well, nobody's ever quite figured out with the ransom game yet how you actually pick the cash up without the police picking you up. So I really can't see any professional thief having done this. A professional would have gone for the lot. It would have been as simple as that. You'd have got your first note. If you hadn't got the money, then you'd have got ripped up painting, chopped up, simple as that. Say, right, there was 10, there is now 9. Now you're going to pay us. And that is exactly how they would behave. Because art means nothing to these people. It's money. Money means everything to these people. And that's all they want. So all they're interested in is money.
The first and only breakthrough in the case came 7 months after the painting went missing, when a 58-year-old businessman, Arsène Houdetier, died of a heart attack after addressing a meeting of the Catholic People's Party. He lived here, 10 miles from Ghent in the small town of Wetteren, was well respected in his local community, and aspired to political office. Houdetier summoned his solicitor to his deathbed and made an astonishing confession.
I alone know where the righteous judges are to be found, in my study, keys, cupboard.
When the solicitor searched the dead man's study, he found carbon copies of all the ransom letters, but nothing to indicate where Houdetier had hidden the righteous judges.
Houdetier was in 1934 beslist een persoon.
Houdetier was in 1934 definitely a person who, in his small town, belonged to what I would call the top 10%, the elite of Wetteren. He was clearly a megalomaniac. He had a big house near the center of town, in fact, right next to the town square. and close to the town hall and church. He had a car, which he usually parked in front of his house to show how rich and important he was.
Pierre van den Derpel, Houdetier's nephew, remembers Houdetier as a man who wanted to be looked up to.
That is niet moeilijk om te beschrijven. Want als je de persoon...
If you saw him, he was obviously a proud man. Always well dressed in white spats, smart suits, and wing collars. There was always a little friction between Houdetier and other people. Houdetier always felt himself to be a little bit superior to other people.
But why does a man who appears to be a pillar of the community confess to robbing a church? Especially when he didn't have to. He could have made his peace with God by confessing to a priest as he lay dying. But he told his solicitor. Why? Because his priest would have been bound to secrecy and his solicitor wasn't. Houdetier wanted the world to know he was clever enough to have pulled off the art crime of the century. This story gets more fantastic by the minute. I can just imagine the reviews if I'd written it. Perpetrator brought in from left field in final pages of novel. Corny deathbed revelations. Unbelievable plot. Improbable psychology. I mean, devout 58-year-old businessmen with dicky hearts, no previous convictions, and money in the bank do not commit acts of gross sacrilege before demanding huge sums in ransom. Or do they? As we're beginning to discover, Houdetier was no ordinary thief. He was a gifted organist with a talent for improvisation, and he was also a competent artist. This portrait of a local dignitary is one of his more celebrated efforts.
Houdetier was dusdanig een goede leerling in...
Houdetier had a good understanding of art and took art classes from the age of 9 or 10. He was quite a good pupil in art and painting and was always top of his class. When he was a bit older, and was still attending drawing classes at the Enlarged Academy of Wetteren, he was awarded a distinction of a medal, of a royal medal of honor for his painting.
Houdetier obviously knew his art, and as far as he was concerned, the most valuable painting in the world was Van Eyck's Adoration of the Lamb. But he didn't steal the righteous judges for the money. He owned a successful stockbroking agency, Plan Texel, and had 3 million Belgian francs in the bank at the time of his death. His wife managed the business, allowing Houdetier time to indulge his passion for detective fiction, in particular the works of Edgar Allan Poe.
Verwijten maakt dat hij niet te veel thuis is.
It was really his wife who kept his stockbroking agency running. And sometimes she complained that he wasn't at home very much, that he spent too much time on trifles, as she called them. She also complained, quite specifically, that he spent too much time with fantasies. What she meant was that he had this tendency to solve detective stories or get involved in them.
You could say, it takes one to know one. But if I had created Arsène Houdetier, I would need to establish his primary motivation. And to do that, I'd consult a friend, psychologist David Cantor. He made legal history by drawing up the first ever psychological profile to be used in a British police investigation. His book, Criminal Shadows, ought to be every crime writer's reference manual.
Dudetier is a most curious mixture of individuals. I mean, we're told he has a sort of church upbringing and he is a strong Catholic. We're told that he's involved in stockbroking, share dealing in some way. But he's also clearly a gifted organist and very much associated with the church. And he's obviously something of a professional painter as well. So we have this very mixed set of activities. We're also told that he has this fascination with crime novels. And it's very intriguing to see the tone of the letters implying that he's some sort of supervillain. He's some sort of clever criminal who has got the better of the bishop and the state, and that they really ought to respond to him.
We recognise that the price demanded is high, but what authority would dare assume the responsibility of rejecting our offer, which amounts to an ultimatum? We know very well that the artistic and cultural world would rise up in indignation if it should learn of such a refusal.
It does seem feasible that he's actually developed his own sort of inner storyline, his own view of himself as the arch-villain who is going to do this sort of bloodless and painless crime that is really going to show everybody how significant he is.
The deathbed revelations begin to seem less corny. This is great stuff. We have an apparently respectable man who lives a life of rectitude while indulging in criminal fantasies of quite staggering proportions. This is an infinitely more interesting basis for a plot. Hudetier and his troubled psyche could have appeared in any one of my books. He was prepared to betray his family to prove his own cleverness. Nor is it far-fetched to call it a murder story. By stealing the righteous judges, Hudetier destroyed Van Eyck's masterpiece. But what did he do with the painting?
In thinking about where a person is going to hide something like this, you've got to first of all take on board the simple practicalities of how big it is, how easy it is to transport, and the risks involved in taking it anywhere to transport it and being spotted. So these have to be places that he has that sort of control over, and therefore places that he knows about. He has to find them in his normal activities, in his day-to-day business dealings, in his day-to-day travels, where he goes to church, where he plays the organ. All these things that he normally does have to be the basis for identifying locations that he will use.
So, where are the righteous judges? Carol Mortier is convinced they never left the cathedral and that the painting is hidden somewhere in the organ loft.
Omdat Rudertier in zijn laatste brief.
In his last letter, which he was unable to send because he died, Rudertier urged Bishop Coppetus not to lose any time in doing whatever was necessary to get the righteous judges back. Because as Rudertier both said and wrote,
the painting of the righteous judges is in a place where neither I nor anybody else can retrieve it without drawing public attention to themselves.
What he meant was that although he could no longer get it back because its hiding place was too public, the bishop could. Hudetier was actually very interested in everything connected with Ghent Cathedral. He was well informed about it, he could come and go as he pleased, and he could even get, and it was later found, a key to the organ where the organist played. This was really extraordinary, because nobody was allowed into the organ loft at that time. They still aren't allowed. They definitely weren't at that time. But Hudetier managed to get a key.
Ook niet. En hij kwam toch in het bezit van een sleutel.
Remember, Houdetier's dying words were, keys, cupboard. The key to the organ loft was one of two keys found in his study after Houdetier's death.
The cathedral theory is a very seductive one, assuming Houdetier's plan was to write a triumphant letter to Bishop Coppetus saying, you've just paid 1,000,000 francs for something that's been under your nose all the time. But was that the plan? On another occasion, he said, there was no theft. Who owns the Lamb of God? The state. And that means all of us. If someone moves something, then it's not stolen.
So if he did move it, where did he move it to? Let's not forget the other key found in his study. If I put myself in Houdetier's shoes, which isn't unreasonable, since we both share a love of crime fiction, and I also spend most of my working days indulging in fantasy, I'd choose a hiding place in Wetteren, where Houdetier lived. The risk of association with me is far outweighed by my intimate knowledge of the environment and the control I can exercise over it. This is St. Gertrude's Church in Wetteren, where Houdetier was verger and organist. Significantly, the other key found in his study was the key to the back door of the church, which meant Houdetier had access to St. Gertrude's day and night via his garden. Certainly I would have felt much safer hiding the righteous judges here than leaving them in Ghent Cathedral.
This is perfect. If I were Houdetier and I wanted a place that I had control over, this would be it. Wonderful. I wasn't expecting anything like this. This is extraordinary. This is the bell tower, and he was the only one who had access to it because he was the bell ringer.
If he did hide the painting here, it's well concealed. The roof was renewed 20 years ago and nothing was found. Of course, this space may only have been a temporary hiding place for the righteous judges. Whatever he did with it, surely part of the brilliance of Houdetier's plan was that no one would suspect a pillar of Wetteren society of sacrilegious vandalism. So what other possible hiding places could there be for the righteous judges?
If one could get a real insight into his pattern of activities and the sort of world he had access to, it ought to be possible to reduce the number of locations that he could have put it in to really relatively few.
The problem is that once Houdetier had confessed, the police effectively stopped looking for the painting. As a result, there's been no systematic search of the numerous organ lofts that Houdetier is known to have visited regularly, and not just the one in Ghent Cathedral. His passion for music gave him entry to any church where the organist was a friend. And what of the 45 properties he owned? Even his own house wasn't properly searched until years after his death, and little or no interest has been shown in the others.
Given that he painted and was very aware of how to look after paintings, and the fact that the St. John came back in immaculate condition, he would have very early on, he would have stored it in a safe place. So I think it's actually very likely that he certainly kept it safe and intact, and therefore there's a reasonable chance that it is still safe and intact.
If this had been one of my novels, it would have had an ending. But sadly, real life is rarely so neat. I may not have found the righteous judges in the few weeks I've been looking for them, but I do know where they are, and they are not in Ghent Cathedral. All the evidence, Houdetier's feelings of superiority towards the people around him, his need, even as he lay dying, to have his cleverness recognized, while knowing it would ruin his family. David Cantor's view that he would have hidden the righteous judges in a place he alone could control. And the fact that he certainly took the painting of St. John the Baptist out of Ghent Cathedral. All of these things point to the respectable little town of Wetteren. That is where one of the most precious paintings in the world is, and that is where the Belgians should be looking for their missing masterpiece.
Ain't no fine.